So in the second video of our five-part series on the most disruptive technologies from different technology sectors, we space nerds, of course, want to look into our favorite topic, the future of manned spaceflight. This industry is still in its early infancy, but already now we can see how fast things are developing, thanks mostly to Elon Musk and SpaceX. And we will soon see some major disruption of classical government-driven spaceflight happen.
And we'll only talk about immediate disruption, so disruption taking place 10, 20, 30 years in the future, because it's quite honestly really impossible to say what will come in 100, 200 years. So there will be no talk about faster than light travel, L-cubic warp drives, matter-antimatter reactors, Dyson spheres, then Newman probes and stuff like that, okay? So only in the immediate future, 10, 20, 30 years maximum. So stay tuned to find out what are, in our opinion, the five most disruptive space-related technologies. Number 5. Inflatable habitat modules.
In many renderings and animations of future Moon or Mars spaces, we couldn't help to notice that a vast majority do not depict inflatable habitats, but rigid metal structures, such as used nowadays on the ISS. However, inflatable habitats are coming and have already been successfully tested many times. The company with the most notable achievement and furthest in this regard is Bigelow Aerospace. Founded by Robert Bigelow already in 1999, the goal is to make cheaper habitats. They don't only take less volume for transport, but are of course also lighter and more resistant against micrometeorites. One of such inflatable habitats has been successfully tested on the ISS. The beam, which was brought to the ISS by a SpaceX Falcon 9 in April 2016.
This inflatable habitat is still docked to the ISS and used as storage space. Now, the next habitats planned for future launches are the BA-330, which would inflated be quite large with a diameter of 6.7 meters, a length of 14 meters, and an interior volumes of 330 cubic meters. Now, the interesting thing about these inflatable habitat modules is that they can also be used for future moon bases or even for future Mars bases. But now the real monster is the BA-2100, which will be the next generation of inflatable habitat modules, which would offer an insane interior volume of 2100 cubic meters. That is twice as much as Starship and over twice as much as the International Space Station. So to recap, those inflatable habitat modules are lighter, cheaper, and safer than classical metal-based rigid habitation modules because their flexibility offers more protection from micrometeorite impacts. So once we see the first inflatable habitat modules by Bigelow Aerospace be carried to low Earth orbit or to the Moon or Mars, we'll see a severe disruption taking place of these classical rigid metal-based habitation modules. Number 4. Asteroid mining. Now, with several companies that already have been founded with the goal in mind to mine asteroids, such as Planetoid Mines, NEO Resource Atlas, Deep Space Industries, Planetary Resources, and many others, we surely will see a giant gold rush taking place, but this time in space.
Why is space so interesting? Well, let's for example take a look at this shiny stuff called gold, which currently is pumping nicely. The World Gold Council estimates that around 187,000 metric tons of gold have already been mined on this planet, with only 57,000 metric tons remaining to be mined, as estimated by the USGS. So in total, there are 244,000 metric tons of mineable gold on this planet. That sounds like a lot, but gold has a high density of 19.32 grams per cubic centimeter. So all gold on this world could be put into a cube with an edge length of only 23.3 meters. Fun fact, all the gold in the universe was probably created by neutron star collisions. One such collision creating an entire Earth mass of pure gold. Insane stuff!
And in the solar system? Like, how much gold or precious metals are there in the solar system? Okay, take 16 Psyche for example, an asteroid which is located in the asteroid belt with a diameter of 200 kilometers. Now it consists mostly of nickel, iron, platinum and yes, also gold. Now how much would all these precious metal on 16 Psyche be worth in today's dollars, you ask? Well, quite a lot, about 10 quintillion US dollars. 10 quintillion. And that is only one asteroid. Because what is the most reliable driver of human exploration of new territories, always has been, and probably always will be? Is it science? Is it like curiosity? Yes, okay, curiosity plays a role, but no, greed. Greed is the most powerful source of human drive. And therefore, we think that this gold rush will take place very soon. Now, who will be disrupted? Well, quite easy. The traditional precious metal markets on Earth will see some kind of brutal disruption. Just imagine what would happen to the gold price if suddenly thousands, no, millions of tons of gold could be mined on asteroids and brought to Earth. Now, you know what would be super nice? If there would exist a digital alternative to gold as a deflationary store of value. Now, that would be super awesome. Oh, right. Number 3, the space elevator.
Now your thought that reusable rockets will make spaceflight cheap, think again. Because this here has the potential to make getting to Earth's orbit ultra cheap. Now how would it work? Simple. Place a heavy counterweight beyond geostationary orbit at around 100,000 km distance. Pull a giant cable, attaching this counterweight with a base station on Earth at the equator. Let the centrifugal force do its thing, tightening the cable. Then attach an elevator and a station at geostationary orbit. And finished. Easy peasy. Now why don't we have such a thing yet? Well, the cable needs to be very strong. Like, insanely strong.
Now this material would need to have a tensile strength of 48 megapascal per kilogram per cubic meter. So what about steel? Steel surely is very strong, right? Well, turns out steel is far too weak with a tensile strength of only 0.63 megapascal per kilogram per cubic meter. But what about Kevlar? I mean, Kevlar surely is strong enough. I mean, it absorbs bullets. It must be super strong, right? Well, it turns out it's also far too weak with a tensile strength of only 2.5 megapascal per kilogram per cubic meter. So we need something far stronger than anything we have right now. But luckily for us, it turns out there could be something. A material based on carbon nanotube fibers. This would enable us tensile strengths of 100 megapascal per kilogram per cubic meter, twice as strong as needed. But there is a small little problem with carbon nanotube materials. The longest strand of fiber ever produced from carbon nanotubes was 1 meter long. Now, this carbon nanotube space elevator strand of fiber would need to be how long? 100,000 kilometers, so 100 million times longer than the longest strand of fiber we have ever created until now in a lab. But if in the future it will be able to produce a 100,000 kilometer long strand of carbon nanotube fiber material, then we could see a space elevator be built and we could see access to orbit be far, far cheaper than it is now. Now the cheapest cost to kilogram for payloads to low Earth orbit nowadays is of course with SpaceX's Falcon 9, with $5,000 per kilogram of payload cost to low Earth orbit. Now how cheap would be a space elevator? $220 per kilogram. That's over 20 times cheaper. This is so cheap that it will even disrupt reusable rocket systems. Speaking of reusable rockets, number 2, reusable rockets.
Okay, this is no surprise. This is a total no-brainer. Our favorite person on planet Earth, this cool guy here, has started a company called SpaceX back in 2002, which has resulted in the capability to reuse rockets. Before that, you would throw away the whole rocket after every launch. Now, a large part of the rocket can be reused, reducing the cost per kilogram of payload to orbit significantly and disrupting the entire space industry. The European Ariana Space or the Russians with their proton rockets, are entirely kicked out of the commercial launch sector. And many try to copy SpaceX's success, such as Blue Origin, Rocket Labs, and many Chinese startups, such as iSpace, LinkSpace, and Space Transportation. This disruption is still ongoing, and will for sure make non-reusable rockets completely obsolete very soon. Space agencies will either adapt or die. That's how simple it is. But there is one reusable rocket, which we want to talk about right now, because it will be so insanely disruptive that we gave it the top spot.
Number 1. Starship and Super Heavy. And among the reusable rocket systems, the most disruptive one will of course be our favorite Starship and Super Heavy, currently under development at SpaceX. So Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy were, or better yet still are, very disruptive to the commercial satellite launch industry. But now Starship and Super Heavy go so much further, it will totally disrupt not only commercial satellite launches, but manned spaceflight as we know it. So why don't we have these Moon or Mars spaces yet? We talked about it quite often, but quite simply because too expensive. But the cool thing about Starship and Super Heavy is that it will be 100% reusable. Like the first stage being the Super Heavy booster, the second stage being the Starship, will be both 100% reusable. In a new 205-page assessment by NASA on Starship and Super Heavy, it is said that Starship and Super Heavy could launch 24 times per year. Now the stats of this beast are of course very impressive. With a bit more than 100 metric tons of payload capability to low Earth orbit, with 100 tons of payload capability to the Moon, and with orbital refueling, even 100 tons of payload capability to Mars. So this rocket system is so brutally far beyond anything else in existence today, it's not even funny anymore. SLS, come on. Okay, it's not even a contender, it has less payload capability, it's not reusable, and it's far, far, far more expensive because of that. What about Blue Origin's New Glenn? Well, New Glenn doesn't even fly yet, and it will be only finished in 2021, and if it will be finished, it will still have less than half of the payload capability of Starship Super Heavy. In fact, the New Glenn will be even weaker than Falcon Heavy, and Falcon Heavy already exists and has flown 3 times. So what about the Russians? The poor Russians don't have anything to counter SpaceX right now and are almost completely kicked out of the commercial launch industry. So what about the Europeans? Well, the new Ariane 6, absolutely not reusable, so it's looking pretty bad also for them.
So yeah, with no competition whatsoever, Starship and Super Heavy will enable to build sustainable colonies on the Moon and on Mars. And this beast can launch again and again, with almost no refurbishment needed, and huge payload capacity. It will enable to fly humans to the Moon, to Mars, and even beyond Mars for the exploration of the solar system. This beast will enable a future of humanity in space, and finally make humanity a multi-planetary species. And there is nothing coming even remotely close to Starship. It cannot get more disruptive than that.
So do you agree with our top 5 space-related disruptive technologies list? Did we miss something? Would you change something? Do you have any other technologies in mind that are more important in your opinion? Let us know in the comment section what you think.
And if you have missed our previous episode on the top 5 most disruptive transportation technologies, we will link to it in the description. Mm-hmm. Check it out!
And currently we're releasing only 1 video per week because we're currently on vacation. We're doing an America road trip, driving around with a Model 3 through the Nevada desert, California, and so on and so forth. Once we return, we'll continue with 2 videos per week. Promise.
Absolutely.